So to close this conversation, speaking of issue-based politics, at the end of the day, does look giving Rift Valley as a clear example that multi-billion projects had stalled for years until we're seeing Uhuru visiting this county for it to be regenerated again. We're talking about the 5 billion bypass in Eldoret, the 30 billion referral hospital that is going to replace Moi Teaching Referral Hospital. Development in this country, are we telling voters that development cannot happen if politics is not
involved? There are two things that happens in this country. Is that if it's the national government or the county government, most of the time we overestimate our budgets. Sometimes when you look at the national budget, we are giving ourselves a big budget that we cannot be able to fund. So that is one of the key causes of the stalled projects or projects that will never be able to continue. So I think Rift Valley as an example is you can actually take Rift Valley and call it a country of its own because the entire 45 tribes live in Rift Valley. So I think what we need to do now is to talk to the youth. We're in high schools, we need to talk to, you know, our people, because really, you know, when you look at the people who are between 45 and above, they're very few. You know, so really now, to go to what he asked, is that the only way we can shield the future leaders, or the current leaders who we are borrowing the leadership from, is by us now realizing that, you know, Kenya is more important than us, you know? And we'll probably go through a 10-year process.
Right. If you allow me to just jump in, Zinzi, you cannot divorce and dissociate politics from development, because the people on the ground need somebody to tear them, to articulate the issues, to bring out the issues at a national level that are pressing them in terms of developmental gaps. And the people, the framework that we have in this country is that those people are politicians.
But Kenya can balance politics and development.
You see, the misnomer that we have is that, you know, development is linked to democracy. I think in many other countries, including the United States, including the United Kingdom, and many other countries where democracy has been historically associated with, they developed outside of democracy.
I look at it differently. In this country, and the president alluded to this fact, if you look at the members of the National Assembly, they are given each, is it 70 million? On CDF?
Yes. NGCDF, yes.
Okay, and then county government also has a budget for their development. You know, a national government has a budget for development. So I believe that we can be able to divorce development from politics.
But you see, the ultimate thing is that it has to be based on numbers. Because if you have a situation where, for instance, Embakasi South has 150,000 voters, and this Lafe has 15,000 voters or 24,000 voters, yet both constituencies get 100 million every year. How does that work? It has to be based on numbers.
Of course,
so if it's democracy, it has to be one man, one vote, one shilling.
Of course, there's that an-ending conversation about whether resources should be allocated based on the geographical size or should be allocated based on the number
people,
of people,
on
maybe
people,
number of voters.
Kilometers.
There's a senator we invited to the show, but he didn't turn up. That is Samson Cherargei. He has texted in and saying that Jubilee Party will remain strong and outlive any imaginations of destruction. It was built on strong foundation of unity, brotherhood, and togetherness. We shall sort out issues within the ambit of the party constitution.
You can link that to what the deputy president said. He'll put his guys in
line.
Okay. And that conversation will not end. Later on, we'll be speaking to the leader of majority at the Senate, Kipchumba Murkomen. I want us now to focus on a topic that came to us the end of last week. That is the Senate going to court to sue the National Assembly based on different matters. I want us to take a look at some of those things. That is, the Senate is claiming that 18 bills have been passed by the National Assembly without the involvement of the Senate, despite the fact that they touch on counties, if we have those graphics. And then that the laws were assented into acts of parliament by the president, and there are also 5 Senate bills that are stuck at the National Assembly. Understandably, the National Assembly has committed them to the Budget and Appropriations Committee to check whether they are money bills, and that the Senate has been frustrating the National Assembly in that enactment of laws. Then the bills enacted without the Senate include the Public Trustee Amendment Act of 2018, Computer Misuse and Cyber Crimes Act 2018, Health Laws Amendment Act of 2018, as well as the National Cohesion Amendment Act. So there are so many others that are in regards to that. And I want to begin with you, Senator Leda Molekina. This is the feeling of the entire House of Senate, and you feel that National Assembly Speaker is not consulting with the Speaker of the Senate. And one wonders, we see them walking together every now and then. We see them during the State of the Nation address walking into the House. What is so difficult for the two leaders of the two houses to concur on these matters?
I don't really think it is between the two speakers, although there could be a problem there in terms of concurrence. But I think this is a behavior of the National Assembly. In fact, they're not 18, they are 39 statutes which have been amended with the argument that they are money bill, with the argument that they do not affect counties. You remember very well we had the Registrations of Persons Act, which introduced a section 9A that brought in the issue of Huduma number. Mm-hmm. I'm on record, and I still stand very firm, that I will never take a Huduma number until that miscellaneous amendment is brought into the Senate for us to be able to look at it, how it affects us, and there's concurrence. It's a matter of principle. Mm-hmm. So I think what we are doing as a Senate is that we want to defend the interest of the country. And I'll tell you how laws are amended. In most cases, when you watch television, sometimes mm-hmm. when you go into the committee of the whole, you mm-hmm. might find that there are probably three or four senators. Mm-hmm. You might find that there are probably 10 members of the National Assemblies who are now tasked with this issue of looking at the laws, you know, amending them or passing those amendments. In most cases, passing amendments. Mm-hmm. So I think it is important. And we have a bill, which is a concurrence bill sponsored, I think, by Senator Mtula Kilonzo and Sakaja on the issue of concurrence. You know, mm-hmm. and it is important that we realize that this is no longer a unitary state. This mm-hmm. is a country that has got two houses of parliament, which makes parliament, you know, and the media can actually drive this narrative, because every time when you hear parliament, mm-hmm. the media is referring to the National Assembly. Uh-huh. I think we need to do this. And normally what happens, in a nutshell, what happens is this. You find an omnibus miscellaneous amendment mm-hmm. where, you know, the National Assembly comes up with all these statutes that needs to be amended. You know, the PFM Act, the Registrations of Persons Act. There are many. And then they are done quickly and they are rushed. Now, the national government also has a show of blame. The executive, in essence. You know, the president is not advised properly on how these laws affect counties. Mm-hmm. And the Supreme Court came up with an advisory, a very strong advisory. And if you read the advisory from the Supreme Court, it says clearly that any lawyer or anyone, any legislator, reading through any bill will find something affecting counties. Mm-hmm. So I think it's just about time that we look into all these laws. We recognize the fact that there are two houses. You know, when you look at the Senate, it is a house made up of 68, including the Speaker,
right.
Senators, which is 47 elected senators. Mm-hmm. You know, each senator, it doesn't matter how many people you have in a county, you have one senator. Mm-hmm. It is a house of union. So it is made to be able to unite this thing. So what we are saying is this, we will not allow any laws to be changed.
Yes.
Without consultation of the Senate, period. Mm-hmm. And that is why we are prepared, we ourselves, as senators, even to pay for the bill of the lawyers to be able to go and represent.
All right. Honorable Lord, you're too quiet on this situation, this specific one. The
yes.
lack of communication, the lack of togetherness between these two houses, is it because of the politics involved? Is it power play, or is genuinely at the heart of it issues that concern Kenyans?
I think the specific 39 amendments
that he's just talked about.
I think the Constitution set out to demarcate very clearly the parameters in which both houses operate. And let me start by disagreeing with my colleague from the Senate on the issue about whether or not all bills need to go to the Senate first in order for them to consider whether they are bills concerning counties. I think under Article 110(3), the Constitution actually says that the role of determining whether that bill is a bill concerning counties is a reserve of both speakers. And it says that before either houses considers a particular bill, the two speakers shall jointly resolve.
There
is no requirement that first it goes to the Senate for them to deliberate and determine whether or not it's a bill concerning counties. Having said that, My view of whether or not this is power play between two houses, the question is yes and no. I mean, this is the historical rivalry between two siblings, and we never really resolved this thing. We missed the boat at Naivasha, I believe, whether or not we wanted an upper house or a lower house, and that thing has never ended, whether or not we should have had one house that can. But you can see very clearly, in my view, that if there is an upper house, then it should be the National Assembly. Because, let me explain. If you read clearly between Article 109 and 114, you will find that whereas the Senate can only originate bills that affect them, the National Assembly can originate any bill. That's very clear. It's in the Constitution. Secondly, when you originate a bill from the Senate, the National Assembly can veto a bill that comes from the Senate. It doesn't happen the other way around. So if there is any question about, in terms of power play, whether there is a house that has, whether you call it the upper house or has more muscle, it is the National Assembly.
Okay.
We can originate any bill, and in any event...
But if you originate a bill and they have a feeling that it's affecting the counties, because don't you feel that you need to consult or concur with the Senate?
I agree. And that's why I've referred you to Article 110. So we should ask both speakers, because when
a bill, from doing that?
They have, because our assumption of members of parliament is that Article 110 is complied to as a condition precedent before a bill comes, because it says before you will consider, the two shall jointly resolve. So whether or not the two resolve or don't resolve is a question that the two speakers
can answer.
Allow me to correct something that he just said.
Just before you do this,
important. Just allow me, because Article 111 is very clear. You know, and you're a lawyer, there are two words, which one is shall, which gives you all the powers, and one is may. Now, in this case where you say that the National Assembly can veto, it is may veto, but you need a two-third majority to veto a bill. Okay?
Yes.
So we have to be very clear. It's may. So in most cases, the tradition of parliament, what happens is that it goes into mediation.
The question I was bringing there was, they asked me whether this is power play, and I brought that historically in terms of the rivalry between who is upper house, who is lower house. I used that to demonstrate that if there could be any house, then the word veto, we may veto, whether may or shall, that similar word is not applied to the Senate. There are no circumstances, whether may or shall, used in respect of the Senate.
But Mheshimiwa Oluoch, and you can join in on this, Onyoka, because you are the House currently. When you say that a bill originating from the National Assembly can originate from the National Assembly, and that you assume that the two speakers have already spoken about it, how much of responsibility do you take as members of Parliament to know whether indeed there has been that level of consultation? Because they feel, and the leader of majority, Kipchumba Murkomen, was very clear that the Speaker of the Senate, the Speaker of the National Assembly has not concurred with the Speaker of the of the National Assembly, has not concurred with the Speaker of the Senate on several bills.
Well, there are two things that can happen. Any member may bring a question for the Speaker to rule on the issue of constitutionality, and we've done that very many times. I've done that myself in respect of presidential exercise of powers under Article 115, whether or not he can express reservations and overturn the lawmaking power of Parliament. So in the event that any member of Parliament feels or thinks that the question of 110(3) has not been resolved, or they think that this is a matter concerning counties and therefore needs to go to the Senate, the issue has come before through the majority leader, the issue has come before when the Speaker himself has pronounced himself and said, by dint of Article 110, this is a matter concerning counties and therefore we need to be concerned. There are very, very many instances when that has happened by the Speaker, the majority leader, and even members can raise
the issues. So what determines whether a bill should first go to Senate?
It doesn't have to first go to Senate. If it originates from Parliament and Parliament, National Assembly can originate any bill.
Yes.
It is first considered. We conclude it, and if it is deemed to be a bill concerning counties, then it has to be referred to the Senate for the Senate to look at it.
No, I think the answer to that question is very clear.
Senator, we need to take a short break. We need to say you'd be taking views
but,
from...
But listen to this. The process is very simple.
Yes.
The two speakers must first concur.
Okay.
Once they concur, then it either goes to the National Assembly,
We need to take a break, but only recently take the views from Mheshimiwa Nyonka and Mheshimiwa Githinji on this back in a moment.